Hey everybody, we're going to be doing a quick Bible study, so stick around after this video. We'll get right into that. I promise you it'll be interesting. And so I wanted to talk to you guys about the coronavirus. Now, something just isn't adding up here. I'm going through the actual amount of deaths, people that have died. And the number that you see on the screen is a worldwide number, okay? This is the worldwide number of deaths, 30,299. Now, not to make light of this, but we all know that when we pass away, it's going to be, you know, they're going to say due to cancer, due to heart disease. If you're in the very small percentage, the coronavirus, so we're all going to die from something. You know, we all have a date and time stamp where we're going to pass away. So, you know, a lot of times the media will say this caused them to die or that caused them to die. Well, you know, we're all going to die from something. There's going to be some reason for it. 100% of everybody is going to die. But what I want to talk about here is I've never seen something so overhyped in my life as the coronavirus. And I know in the media and in the on the internet and everywhere, it's like, you know, you got to walk lockstep like a Nazi and put your mask on and do all this other stuff and stock up on toilet paper. But as a conservative Christian, I like to look at the numbers and the facts. I'm not going to let emotions or the media or the mass population, the mob, affect truth. So what I'm going to show you is truth, and you make your own decision if the coronavirus is a big scam that's overhyped. So fact, we know that the coronavirus exists, but this is the actual death toll since, you know, we've known about the coronavirus, and we're doing this video on March 28, 2020. Now, remember this number, 30,299. This is nothing. This is absolutely nothing when you're looking at worldwide death. So I'm going to show you a chart that shows, again, remember we talked about how everyone dies from something, but I'm going to show you a chart of things that are much more dangerous than the coronavirus. And let's go to that right now. Now remember, 30,299. Now, this number is actually growing. Here's the chart of the top causes of death from 1990 to 2017. Now watch this. I'm going to press play. See how it grows like that? So if anything, this number will be increased when they get the data from 2018 to 2019. So one more time, watch this. So as the population grows, of course, you're going to have more people in this pool dying. So do you remember the number? Like the 30,000 number, cardiovascular disease per year, 17.79 million. Well, let's go, you know, shut down all the businesses and shut down everything because people are getting cardiovascular disease. Now, I know what people are going to say. The reason why people are like some people, I don't mean you, of course, but the reason why some people are all paranoid, schizophrenic about the coronavirus is because if someone has heart disease, not to be cold or mean, but you're not going to catch heart disease from them. It's not something where you can catch it. But look at the amount of people from heart disease, dying from heart disease, than the coronavirus. We should be, you know, more concerned with McDonald's Big Macs or, you know, fatty foods. You know, it's like people should be, instead of putting a mask over their face, they should like keep the cheeseburger away from their face or whatever. Now, but even if they ate really, really healthy, they're still going to die. Now, look at cancers, 9.56 million, and this dwarfs the coronavirus. You know, let's even get to some of these other things. Respiratory diseases, 3.91 million. But look at this. If you could see it, let's see if I can enlarge this. That really didn't help that much, but that looks a little bit more legible here. Drowning, just by drowning in water, that's still higher than the coronavirus, 295,210. Put this video on full screen. Look at hepatitis, 126,391. What about people that are, you know, drunks and they drink a lot? 184,934 for alcohol use disorders. Parkinson's disease, 340,639. HIV AIDS, 954,492. Diabetes. Now, we all know people that have diabetes, cancer, you know, heart disease. We all know these people. I've asked everyone I know, every single person I know, do you know anyone that has coronavirus? They say no. I go, do you know anyone that knows anyone that knows anyone that has coronavirus? They say no. It's, guys, you could win the lottery. Your chances of winning the lottery are higher than, you know, getting the coronavirus and dying from it. Look at dementia. 2.51 million people from that. All these numbers are higher than this little, it's like a pinprick on a map of coronavirus. It's way, let's just be honest. I'm going to say it. I am going there. This thing is way overhyped. Now, I have a theory why this coronavirus is way overhyped. You notice in the U.S., Trump wasn't making a big deal about it, you know, in the beginning. He was, like, doing certain things. He was banning travel from China. But he wasn't, like, you know, where you'd hear about it like ad nauseum, like how we hear about it every day, you know, on the news now. Even the White House is coming out weekly with these reports ad nauseum. They're not talking about cardiovascular disease or cancers or all these major killers, if you want to say that. Do you know, even people, look at right here, fire, if you get burnt in fire, okay, or accidental poisoning, or even heat exposure, like you're out in the heat, you know, that, those deaths are higher than this measly, that's right, I said it, coronavirus. People that are worried about coronavirus, listen, and they're paranoid and scared about it, they're not good at math. That's right, I said it. People that are paranoid schizophrenic about the coronavirus, they need to look at this chart. They're just not good at mathematics. Now, it's like the global warming nuts out there and the environmental wackos. They always talk about what could happen. Yeah, but, you know, if we don't do this, you know, in 10 years, the Earth's going to burn up on fire, you know, and there'll be no oceans and all the forests will be burnt down and the rainforest will be non-existent. They're always talking about what possibly could happen, and we know it never happens. Al Gore, remember his movie, The Inconvenient Truth? And that movie has been proven to be just a bunch of bunk and hogwash. You know, his predictions were all wrong. Everyone's still here. The Earth's doing fine. But look at all these, you know, deaths from certain things. So it's obviously hyped up. No one's talking about these other things when these are the real killers. Boy, just cardiovascular disease alone, 17.79 million. Look at this, respiratory diseases. So let's go back to the coronavirus chart, and then I'm going to show you something that is going to blow your mind. Okay, so we're back to the coronavirus chart. Notice 30,299 deaths. This is nothing. This is absolutely nothing in the big scheme of things when you look at everything. But I'm going to show you something. When I was talking to this with my mom, talking about this with my mom, and my mom looked at the abortion numbers, and she couldn't even speak. She was floored by how many babies are murdered through abortion. And here's something that I want to talk about. If people are this outraged over the coronavirus, they need to be 100 times more outraged, 500 times more outraged. I'm going to show you the number. They need to be extremely outraged about how many, lives are being taken through abortion. Check this number out. 10,185,643.44. This is worldwide abortions. The other chart that you saw with all the deaths was also worldwide. The coronavirus, we have like around 30,000 deaths, but look at the lives being lost through abortion per year. This isn't, 5 years or 10 years. This is a live count right now, 10,185,000. By the time this video is over, it's gonna be well over 10,186,000, just in the twinkling of an eye. This has got my mom practically crying. She couldn't even say it. She was like, "I can't believe, people would, murder their own children." Now, there's two arguments that the pro-abortion, the pro-murder groups use. One is they'll say, "It's my body." But ladies, women, we love you. If you want to change your hairstyle, knock yourself out. You want to get breast augmentation or your lips plumped up, knock yourself out. That's your body. You want to murder the baby? Now we got a problem. That's not your body. It's a separate body. It's not your legs or your arms, your lips or your breast or anything like that. It's a separate body. Now, that's myth number one. The baby is not their body. Myth number two is they'll say we should keep abortion safe and legal, and they'll say, and try to make it where it's not as frequent. Well, first of all, there's no such thing at all as a safe abortion because you're murdering someone. You can't murder and say it's therefore safe. So this is another error, I would even say a lie, that the pro-abortion murder groups will perpetuate. And this is why we must, you guys, we must confront these people that are pro-abortion. We can be civil, but we're not going to pull any punches when we speak. It is murder in its purest form. And the amount of people that are dying being murdered through abortion, it's preventable. It's easier to prevent than the coronavirus. And you saw the numbers. Let's take a look at what they're at now. So just like I mentioned, we're already at 10,186,000, hitting 150 right there. So people that are paranoid, schizophrenic, and worried about coronavirus, let's be at least equally worried about the killing of the innocents. So what we're going to talk about today, guys, is the worldwide flood. We're going to talk about this, and I believe that the flood was a worldwide flood. It wasn't a localized flood, because scripture doesn't say that God said, build this ark, and we're not going to have a worldwide flood. If it wasn't a worldwide flood, my theory is why wouldn't God just say, well, go over to this area. I'm going to flood this area where you're at, so I need you to move out of this area. Obviously, it was a worldwide flood because God had Noah create the ark. So you'll hear this even from some Christians, and they're entitled to their opinion. They'll say, well, I'm starting to believe that it was a localized flood or whatever. Why wouldn't God just tell them to just go to a different area? Why would you have to build an ark if it was a localized flood? It doesn't make sense. Remember in Sodom and Gomorrah, where the angels come and they warn Lot and his family, you got to get out of this area, God's going to destroy this area. And so they just went to another area, and then God destroyed that area of Sodom and Gomorrah. So I do not believe that the people are correct that say the flood was a localized flood, because God could have just told them, as I mentioned, go somewhere else. You didn't have to build an ark if you just can, you know, move somewhere else. So let's go through this. It says, now it came to pass when men began to multiply on the face of the earth and daughters were born to them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men, that they were beautiful, and they took wives for themselves of all whom they chose. And the Lord said, my spirit shall not strive with man forever, for he is indeed flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. There were giants on the earth in those days, and also afterward, when the sons of God came into the daughters of men, and they bore children to them. Those were the mighty men who were of old, men of renown. Now, what I see in this next passage, you guys, it's very similar to what's happening right now, where the world is becoming more and more wicked. And look what happens here. The Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth, and that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. And the Lord was sorry that he had made man on the earth, and he was grieved in his heart. So the Lord said, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, creeping thing and birds of the air, for I am sorry that I have made them. Now notice, what does that say? He doesn't say he's going to destroy a certain area of the earth. He says, I will destroy man whom I have created from the face of the earth, both man and beast, creeping thing and birds of the air, for I am sorry that I have made them. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Then it goes through, and I won't go through the whole thing here, the genealogy of Noah. But notice, the next passage says, the earth also was corrupt before God, and the earth was filled with violence. So God looked upon the earth, and indeed it was corrupt, for all flesh had corrupted their way on the earth. And we just talked about the abortions that are going on. What the secularists are trying to do is cheapen life. And when you can cheapen life and you can call a human life just a blob of cells, then all morality goes out the door. What won't someone do? What can't someone do if they can murder a baby? Think about that. They've now stooped to the lowest of the low. And these were the times right here. Notice, God says to Noah, the end of all flesh has come before me, for the earth is filled with violence through men, and behold, I will destroy them with the earth. Make yourself an ark of gopher wood, excuse me, make rooms in the ark, and cover it inside and outside with pitch. Now, before we go through this, I have absolutely no doubt that the ark really existed, that Noah, even though he had no idea how to do this, God is telling him how to build the ark, and he's following, you know, God's instruction. The ark just wasn't prepared like in a day. So remember, in those days, the earth didn't have all this pollution, and it didn't have all the man-made chemicals we're putting in food and things like that. So Noah was even like 500 years, he lived to be like 500 years old and a little older than that. So it had taken Noah not days or months, but years and years and years, you can go to Answers in Genesis or creation.com if you want to look into the timeline of how long it had taken to produce the ark. And also, if you go to shockofgod.com, I'm not going to go there right now, but you can go to shockofgod.com and it shows you mathematically how all the animals that were there at that time were able to fit on the ark. So God goes through this and he talks to them about how to create the ark, the measurements of the ark. Now look what he says. Behold, I myself am bringing floodwaters on the earth to destroy from under heaven all flesh in which is the breath of life. Everything that is on the earth shall die. But I will establish my covenant with you, and you shall go into the ark, you, your sons, your wife, and your sons' wives with you. And of every living thing of all flesh, you shall bring two of every sort into the ark to keep them alive with you. They shall be male and female, of the birds after their kind, of animals after their kind, and of every creeping thing of the earth after its kind. Two of every kind will come to you. Notice this. Two of every kind will come to you to keep them alive. This is interesting. So Noah's not having to go out there and round all these animals up. God has these animals, these species, come to the ark. You ever notice how animals have this built into their nature? Like, you know, beavers will build dams. The swallows will fly back to Capistrano. There's certain things in different natures of animals where they just have this built into them where they will do these certain things. And so God triggers this natural ability to go to a certain spot in the animals, and they go to the ark. And you shall take for yourself of all food that is eaten, and you shall gather it to yourself, and it shall be food for you and for them. Thus Noah did according to all that God commanded him. So he did. Then the Lord said to Noah, come into the ark, you and all your household, because I have seen that you are righteous before me, in this generation. And then notice we said he was like over 500 years old. Look, Noah was 600 years old when the flood waters were on the earth. Now, let's go to this part. Now, the flood was on the earth 40 days. The waters increased and lifted up the ark, and it rose high above the earth. The waters prevailed and greatly increased on the earth, and the ark moved about on the surface of the waters. Guys, this was a worldwide flood. You know, the scientists have found, say it with me, folks, proof and evidence that at one time the entire earth was covered with water. The entire earth. And notice the waters prevailed exceedingly on the earth, and all the high hills under the whole heaven were covered. Notice, if all the high hills are covered, it's a worldwide flood. The waters prevailed 15 cubits upward, and the mountains were covered. Notice, all the mountains are covered. How can you get all the mountains on the earth covered in a localized flood? So I don't know where these people are getting this. They're just not getting it from scripture. It is a worldwide flood. And all flesh died that moved on the earth. All flesh died that moved on the earth. All. And it goes through all the list here. Only Noah and those who were with him in the ark remained alive, and the waters prevailed on the earth 150 days. Now, you know what's interesting? We're going to cut real quick to something that Jesus Christ said, and it does seem that most people you talk to, they all believe they're going to be okay and they're going to go to heaven. So we're going to go right here where Jesus talks about the narrow way, and we're at Matthew 7:13. So you notice when you're reading scripture and you see God's judgment, it's always the few that are saved. It's not the majority that are saved. We'd all agree with that. It's always a few that are saved. Remember in Sodom and Gomorrah, there was a handful of people that were saved and the rest were judged. With the judgment of the earth with the flood, there's a handful of people that are saved and some animals, but the majority are judged. And it always seems to be the same exact way throughout scripture. Then why is it that your unbelieving friends and my unbelieving friends feel they're going to escape judgment? Where are they getting this information from? Because that does not match up with reality. Even Jesus Christ says here, listen, enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and there are many who go in by it, because narrow is the gate, and look at, difficult is the way which leads to life. And this is some heavy words right here, and there are few who find it. Now let's let that sink in. Why is it that almost everyone believes that they're going to heaven when that contradicts reality of what Christ says when he says there are few who find it? And look what sweet, gentle, meek, loving Jesus says in this next passage. I just love these people that say, you know, we don't need to preach judgment, you know, to people. We just want to talk all about the love of God. God is so loving, and it is true that God is so loving, but he also is righteous and he must judge sin. And I don't think people are really going to appreciate the love of God and what Christ had to do on the cross unless they first realize that they've sinned against a holy God, a righteous God. So look what sweet, gentle, meek, loving Jesus says here. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say, there's that word. Remember, it's always the many that are being judged and few that are being saved. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name? Have we not cast out demons in your name and done many wonders in your name? So these people are doing things outwardly that you would think they're Christian. And Jesus, sweet, lovable Jesus, who, you know, judges no one, the world said, he says, and then I will declare to them, I never knew you, depart from me. Like, he's like, get out of here, you who practice lawlessness. Then Jesus starts talking about people that are fools. He says, therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, this is you and I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain descended, the floods came, and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. You know, I'm not going to mention the YouTube channel, but there's this Christian girl, and she was, you know, doing a video on how she was saying that there's too much judgment from Christians. And I was like, what planet does she live on? I'm not doubting she's a Christian, okay? But what planet does she live on? That's the complete opposite of what I see. Most Christians have no problem speaking of the love and forgiveness of God, and we should always do that, but we need to preach the whole message that there is a judgment. if someone's house was on fire, you know, wouldn't you be yelling and trying to get that person out of that house? You know, you need to talk to them that their house is on fire, and you know, they, like Jesus said, that everyone's already judged. Without Jesus Christ, people will go to hell. Remember that Joel Osteen interview where he was being interviewed by what's that dude with the suspenders, Larry King? And Larry King said, "Now, Joel, you know, what about people that aren't Christians? Do you think they're going to go to hell or whatever?" And Joel Osteen was like, "Well, I'm not one to say, you know, I shouldn't say it. I mean, that's between them and God. I mean, that's not what Jesus said." Jesus warned of hell more than anyone in Scripture. But anyways, back to this. So this Christian girl on YouTube was saying that we shouldn't talk about the judgment of God. Well, that's what Scripture says. Again and again, what was Jesus' message? Remember, Jesus' message wasn't, "I came here to save you." It was, "Repent and be saved." So notice what Jesus says here. He says, "But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish man." This is sweet, gentle, meek, loving Jesus talking about people being foolish, that they built their house on the sand. You listening, my atheist friends? Your house, it's built on the sand. My Muslim friends, your house is built on the sand. Jesus Christ is calling the atheists, the Muslims, the Hindus, foolish people that built their house on the sand. Now, why is it wrong that you and I tell these people that they're like the foolish man that built their house on the sand? Why would that be wrong? Someone very loving, when I was an atheist, told me that I was going to hell and there's no other way to avoid hell unless we put our hope, faith, and trust in Jesus Christ. And I'm very appreciative to that person. That person really loved me. It is not love to not talk about these passages. That is love. What the world says is love is you just leave them alone and let them go to hell. But what Jesus said is we're to warn them. Remember, he said, "Go out and preach the gospel to all the world." Notice, he says the people that will not accept Jesus Christ, they're like a foolish man who built his house on the sand, the atheists, the Muslims, the Hindus. Guys, why do we say this now? It's not to defend, not to offend those people, but to defend the gospel. And we love those people. We love the atheists. We love the Hindus. We love the Muslim. They are going to hell. And if we're not going to tell them now, when are we going to tell them? So I, for one, I am not going to take the tranquilizing pill of, you know, tolerance and just, you know, tolerate these other worldviews that are antichrist. Atheism is antichrist. Islam is antichrist. Hinduism, Buddhism, anything that denies that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, that he died, that he rose again, that he's returning again, it is of the antichrist. Are you willing to say it? Are you willing to get a backbone? I want you to do this right now, you guys. Get your thumbs, put them in front of you. Now bring them around your back. Rub that up and down your back. Those bumpy things, it's called the spine. May God help us if we don't use it. It's time that we man up, or if you're a woman, woman up. And we preach this gospel without compromise. Because let me tell you something, your atheist friends, they're preaching. They're preaching their worldview without compromise. Your Muslim friends, they're preaching. They're preaching it without compromise. Well, why don't you do the same thing? So notice what Jesus says. And the rain descended, the floods came, the winds blew and beat on that house, and it fell. And my atheist, Muslim, Hindu friends, anyone that's not a Christian, great will be your fall. And so it was when Jesus had ended these sayings that the people were astonished at his teaching. Notice, he's not talked to them like Muhammad, who was just a prophet, who was a man who said he was a prophet, and he died and he stayed dead. He's not talking to them like Richard Dawkins, who's just a man that contradicts himself. Notice he's teaching them as one having authority and not as the scribes, you know, the other teachers. Notice authority. Now, sometimes people will say to you, well, where does it say that we're already judged without Jesus Christ? I'm going to show you the passage. So you want to talk to your friends about John 3 and go to John 3:16 and right through 18. And Jesus is talking to this Pharisee and he says, look, he's talking about the Son of Man. He's the Son of Man. He's the Messiah, Jesus Christ. And he says, look, he who believes in him, Jesus Christ, is not condemned. But he who does not believe is condemned already. What the heck? Look at this sweet, gentle, meek, loving Jesus. He's saying the atheists are condemned already. The Muslims are condemned already. The Hindus are condemned already. The Wiccans, the pagans, they're condemned already. This is what Jesus is saying. There's no denying it. Well, why are they condemned? I thought that we were saved because Jesus died and rose from the dead. Yeah, but they're atheists. They're in an antichrist worldview. They're Hindus or pagans or Wiccans. They're in an antichrist worldview. They're Muslims. That's antichrist. So he says they're condemned already. Why? Because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And you know what I love about Jesus Christ? He talks about why people reject Jesus Christ. I'm going to tell you guys why your atheist friends reject Jesus Christ. I'm going to tell you why your Muslim, Hindu, Wiccan, pagan friends reject Jesus Christ. There's some sin within their life that they love and they can't stop doing it. They don't want to get rid of it. It's always that way. Whenever I have a pagan that I've been talking to in the chat room, oh, by the way, you go to shockofgod.com, you can chat with us there, the chat room's up, or an atheist that we bring to Jesus Christ and some Muslims that we brought to Jesus Christ, they always will say, yeah, you know, here's the problem. They were doing drugs or they were sleeping around or they were doing, and they feel that they cannot come to Jesus Christ because they know that stuff's got to change when they come to Jesus Christ. Because it is true that Jesus said, repent and be saved. Repent means to turn from. So notice, Jesus says, why aren't they forgiven? Why are they rejecting him? He explains why. There's no mystery to it. You know and I know that what I'm about to tell you is the truth. He says, this is the condemnation, that light has come into the world and men love darkness rather than light. Why do most robberies happen at nighttime, you know, in carjackings and a lot of evil things happen at nighttime? Well, because you can't see the perpetrator as well. He says, and men love darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil. But why do people that are pro-life and they're good folks and they're pro-life and they're holding up pro-life signs, they hold up the signs in the light. They want everyone to see it, this giant sign. Because everyone practicing evil hates the light and does not come to the light, lest his deed should be exposed. But like the people holding up the pro-life signs and people shining the light. But he who does the truth comes to the light. Why? Because they want their deeds clearly seen, that they have been done in God. So guys, this coronavirus thing, people that are scared and terrified about the coronavirus, they're just not good at mathematics. Click share below this video, send it to them, and I'm going to show you the chat room real quick. So we've updated the website, and now you notice we have the American theme here. You go here, enter chat, and you'll be in the chat room. Hold your mouse over more right here, and I'm going to show you some good things. You can go here and read about the historical Jesus. If you have a slow PC, go down here where it says speed up PC, and it'll show you how to speed it up, different settings you can tweak. Free audiobooks here. Let's see what else we our other chat network. But here's the inner chat area right here. You click here and I'll show you what happens. And then you'll put your name in here. I mean, don't put mine, but you know. And you click connect and you'll be in our chat room. If you have a headset mic, you can talk to your friends there. We'll be there all throughout today and tomorrow at shockofgod.com.